Hi, this is MC Jetty for a new episode of my modding tutorials, and this is episode 22. In this episode we're going to talk about storing data in the world and also storing data in on a player. We already know how to store data in tile entities and also in items using NBT, but you can also do it on the world and in player, and in some cases that's required. So what we're going to make is a mana system. So let's make the package. So basically the idea is that there will be mana bubbles in the world, and so the player has to look for them, and he can then, using his wand, extract the mana to himself. So the mana is not stored on the wand, mana is stored on the player, so if he loses his wand, the mana doesn't go away. And then he can use that mana with his wand to do something special. So let's see, what do we have? So first we have world mana. This is a class a class that we want to store with our world. World save data is a class that you can extend, and it's possible to register instances of this either with each dimension or with or globally over the entire Minecraft world. In our case we are going to do it per dimension. So you have to give it a name, preferably something that is unique, because it will be stored on disk that way. And you have to add these two constructors. They are both needed, even though apparently this one isn't used, but it's used internally. So, and you give the name as a parameter. Then you typically add this getter, which you will use in the rest of the code to get an instance for a given world. So first you ask to get per world storage, and from that storage you get or load the data. So if the data is not present, this method will make an instance of this, and if it's present it will load it. There is also get get map storage, which you can also use instead, and this is the global one. Even though you call it on world as well, it doesn't matter if the world is one of the nether or another dimension, it will always be the same map storage, but this one is unique per dimension. So actually, I was wrong, this method doesn't create it, but it either loads it from a disk, or else it uses what it loaded before to make a new one. If it isn't there yet, you need this code. So here you create a new instance and you do set data. These are codes, these I will explain later. What you also need to do is these two, that's to actually read and write the data to NBT. So let's copy some other things. First let's copy mana sphere. So basically this represents a sphere in the world with a given center and a radius and a current amount of mana that is in that sphere. So there are setters and getters, and here are a few functions. This is important. This trick that I use here is something you want to use when you are doing world gen type v1 features. This is not strictly WorldGen, but it's related to the world. So you want to have randomness, but it has to be consistent with regards to the position where you are. We only allow one mana sphere per chunk, 0 or 1, but a mana sphere can be a lot bigger than one chunk. The maximum radius can be 100, which is rather large. So that means that when you check if a given chunk has mana, has a mana sphere, you want a consistent result no matter in which order the chunks are loaded. So you want a random generator that has a fixed seed calculated from the given chunk coordinates. In this case, you do this by, the best way to do this is to use the seed of the world and multiply the x and the z of the chunk coordinate with some prime numbers. Chunk coordinates, by the way, are like normal coordinates, except every 16 blocks is a different chunk. So this method says with a 0.03 chance there is this is a center of a mana sphere. If it is a mana sphere, then it will have this radius at that position. If there is no mana sphere, then this method should not be used. And this is how high the mana sphere is. And it's consistent no matter from what direction the player walks into an area, because the randomness depends on the chunk coordinates. So in World Mana itself, we have methods to get the mana influence, the mana strength, and to extract mana, and also to grow mana. So initially, mana in the sphere is zero, but gradually over time, if the chunk is loaded, it will grow the mana. So that's what happens here. Actually, we should probably hold on, because there's not always a sphere, we should test for that. It doesn't matter as much, because if this radius is zero, it will not be used anyway, but we don't have to do this if the radius is zero. That's because every chunk we do actually keep in this one. Every chunk will have a mana sphere, even if the mana sphere is empty, if it's a zero radius. So that's what we do here. So we check get or create sphere, that's the method. So first we at a given chunk position, chunk pos is a class that keeps an x and a z for a chunk coordinate. It's a vanilla class. So we check if we have a sphere there. If not, we create one, otherwise we return it. So we get random y offset, radius is zero, unless it's a center chunk. So we do create a sphere at every chunk, but it can be an empty one. That's what's happening here. So every tick this method will be called later. The code for that isn't there yet, but we'll copy that in a moment. So to make the world the work not too expensive, we don't only work every 10 ticks. Then we grow the mana. As this one, that means that for every sphere that is not empty and that is loaded, we get the current mana. We add a small fraction, we cap it, that not never higher than 5, and we set it again. And actually, I forgot, we should mark dirty here. remember, it's also MarkDirty is also needed to make sure the storage is actually persisted to the world. Otherwise, it will not happen. You only have to do this if something changes. So actually, let's put it here. So that's grow mana, so that makes sure the mana grows in the world gradually. Send mana is a method which will send over the current mana status to all players that are in this world, so that they can they know how much mana there is client side, because this structure only exists server side, and if we want to show the mana to the player, we need it client side, and that's what happens here. So that helps everything. So first, let's do that. So we have the mana tick handler. That's the one that we'll call tick every time. So we also have to register that in common proxy. So that means that it's also registered on the event bus, and we subscribe here to the event world tick event, which happens every tick, and it ticks a few times. If you go look at it, there's a start and an end phase. We are only interested in the start phase. So that's what happens here, then we call our tick method here. Okay. Now we need the packet to send the message, to send the mana to the player. So we have mana, influence, and player mana, which we read and write as floats to our byte buffer. And this is the constructor, and this is the handler on the client side, which will put store the message data in the overlay render, but we don't have that one yet. Messages have to be registered, so we need this extra line, that client side message. So now let's explain a few things more. There's mana influence and mana strength. Basically, when you are at a given position, you calculate a chunk position from that, and you go check in the chunks in an area of 9 by 9 around that chunk position, because the maximum radius is 100. And actually, sorry, I'm looking wrong. The maximum radius is 60. 60 is approximately 4 chunks away. That's why we need to check in an area this size to be sure that at our current position there are no mana spheres that overlap our current position. We don't have to check further, because mana spheres that are 5 chunks away can never reach us. So we get the chunk at that position, we check if there's a sphere. Also, this can be done more efficiently, we don't need to calculate the square distance like that, only if it's greater than 0. So what does this do? This calculates the squared distance between the center of the sphere and our position, and if the squared distance is smaller than the squared radius, then we actually calculate the distance by taking the square root. This is because square root is an expensive operation, and so we only and calculating the square distance is relatively cheap. And here we add the amount of potential mana to this variable. So this is actually, if we are right at the center of a manosphere, then this will be 1. So that's a maximum mana influence you can have from a sphere. Of course, if there are multiple spheres overlapping, you can get higher than 1 even. Mana strength is similar. Again, let's add that one. Again, we calculate the distance. And we calculate the factor, which is the mana influence. This actually, let's call it influence, like that. And the mana strength is the current mana in a sphere multiplied with the influence. So that's the mana strength that is at that position. Then we have extract mana. So we get mana influence like that, and again like that. So we get the current mana at that position. Actually, so that's the, so the influence determines how much of the mana we can extract. So by the way, these calculations are just for demo purposes. You can use a much more realistic calculation based on the internal volume of the sphere, for example. This is just for demonstration purposes, just to show that something works. So we subtract the mana from the sphere, the influence from the mana from the sphere, we add that to what we extracted, and we update the mana in the sphere, and then we mark 30. So extract mana will be called when the player uses his wand to get mana from the world. Now let's add our wand, which is just a very simple item wand. We need to add it to our mod items. Like that. And like that. And also like that. Let's add the language entry for it. Like that. And the model file, which is just, instead for the ingot we use generated, but for the wand we use handheld, because it's something you typically keep in your hand, like a sword. And then a very ugly texture. I hope you can do better than this. Okay. So the wand will have two functionalities when it is right clicked. If the player is sneaking, we want to charge mana from the world. So that happens here. We get the world mana, we extract mana from the world, and we store it with the player, which I will explain later, and we return success that we did something. This is a bit a special way to return result, return success, because you can indicate with what item it was. We only do this server side. If the player is not sneaking, we use the mana if we have more than 3 collected on the player. And this is what we do with it. We just play a little sound all this work, all this mana for playing sounds. Maybe we'll add something more special in a future tutorial, so, but this is just for demonstrations. So we now covered storing mana with the world. Now we want to store mana with the player as well. Let's make a new package for that. And storing anything with a player is preferably done with capabilities. So we will create our own capability, but it's a bit limited in that it's not normally when you create capabilities, it's meant for other mods to implement. For example, you could have a new type of power, you implement a capability for it, and other mods implement that capability in their code. But our player mana is private to our mod. Other mods should not implement it, so it's a bit more limited. So we don't need to implement the capability fully. So first, player mana itself. This is the actual class that stores the mana with the player, just a single float. And it has a method to save and load that data from NBT that will be stored with the player. It has a get and a set, getter and setter, and a copy from, which I will explain later. So that's a basic class which will represent our capability. Normally when you register capabilities, you use an interface and an actual implementation implementing that interface. But that's, in our case, that's not needed. So, player properties. This capability inject will make sure that this field will contain the implementation of our capability. So this is something that is will be filled in at registration time, and it will contain our capability that we can then use to get the capability from the player. It's a bit similar. It's a bit similar to object holder in a way, because this is also something that gets filled in when the given item is registered, and this is a similar system. Then properties dispatcher. So this is a capability provider. Actually, I just changed it. Instead of the two interfaces I was using in the moment, I use capability serializable, which is basically a capability provider and something to serialize the capability with. So we have our player manas, which is the implementation. So basically, player mana actually represents the data. Normally this would be an interface and player mana would be the implementation. And here we have the actual storage of our capability data. We implement has capability and get capability. Those two are from capability providers. And we implement serialize and deserialize, which are from serializable. So this is the data that actually represents our capability with its corresponding capability data. And this is what we want to attach to the player. And to do that, we add another events class that we also have to register. Here to the event bus, and it subscribes to two events. First, on entity constructing, so that's an attach capabilities event entity. we only attach this to players. So this event can be used fired whenever an object with capability support tile entity item entity is created. So this way, when subscribing to this event, you can attach capabilities to anything of these three types at least. In our case, we only want to attach this to players. Mobs don't have mana. If we don't already have the player mana, then we add it. We give it a unique ID and we attach our properties dispatcher, which will be responsible for getting and storing the data. So that's how we can get capability there. But there's another event we have to do. When the player dies, you know that when you die, all inventory is gone. You start clean, as it were. So to make sure, that also goes for capabilities. So to make sure the play capability, the mana is not lost, you have to implement this. So the player is, you get a clone event, which is fired whenever a player is revived. You check if the player really was deaf, because otherwise it's not needed to do the copy. So if the original has that capability, player mana, we get the old player mana, we make a new one on the new player, and we do copy from. That's why that copy from method was there. This is important. If you don't do this, when the player dies, the capability will be gone, and you will get a fresh one, which is not what you want to do. Okay. So now we also have to register our capability. Let's copy that code. That's a bit bigger. So basically, capability manager register our capability data. A storage, but we don't actually need that in this case, because our capability has its own storage here, and it's a private one. Other bots will not have to implement instances of this capability, so we don't support this. This will never be used, but you have to give it anyway. Again, for this one, that's the factory that creates player mana, but we also don't need this. But you do have to register the capability, because otherwise this will not get filled in. Yeah, okay. Then when the player is holding the wand in his hand, we actually want to show it. So that's another thing that we have to do. So let's copy the entire package. Where is it? Yeah, here. So basically, it's overlay render, and we listen to the render game overlay event. It's again a forge event, but this time it's only for the client proxy in pre-init. So it's the same principle, but it only happens client side. And what do? We have the set mana, which is what our message from the server will call. So this gets the data from the server every 10 ticks. We only want to work, so this render game overlay event is called at various stages. Here you see all the possible elements that can be shown. And we want to show it at the same stage as the experience is rendered, but only if the player has the wand in his hand. So we disable lighting. We don't have to restore that, because that's how it's supposed to be at this stage. But it's safer to put this here in case some other render does bad things. We are going to keep it simple. you just draw the mana, the influence, and the player mana on the world. Let's think. I think I have everything. Yeah, so we can try it out. So, as soon as we start, the mana will start growing. So let's take our wand. And if we hold it in our hand, you can see the data. So we have no mana in our player. We have influence 0.36. Let's move. It goes down, so it's moving in this direction. Yeah, it's going up. Still going up. So we are close to a center of pretty. Oh no, it's going down. Let's go up. No, it's probably somewhere underground, but we can charge our wand here. So we see the mana is growing. Let's sneak right click a few times, spam click. So the mana is depleted, we have to wait until it grows again. Let's go to another area. Influence goes down, see if I can find some other mana. Oh, here's another one. Yeah, we're almost at 3, so we can use our wand. There's nothing here. Okay, so we have enough to do our spell. Voila! Our first spell. Wasn't it amazing? So that's basically... Did he finally die? The sheep that was going up and down all the time. So that's basically it. For this, I hope it was clear. You can store any kind of data in the world and any kind of data on the player. It's a very flexible system. I use it a lot in my mods. For example, Xnet uses the world storage to save connectivity network work for the cables. By doing that, I can avoid having to use style entities for the cables because I can store it in a more efficient way. The RF tools uses this world storage for the teleportation system. All the destinations for matter receivers are stored in that data. The one probe uses it to remember if the player already got that note here, the one probe readme. So that's also something you can do. So basically that concludes this tutorial. In the next tutorial we will probably work on making this mod a bit more fancy, better overlay render, because it's not very nice right now, better wand effects, and maybe some other things, and some better special effects. So see you next time. Bye bye.